Hi. I didn't want to shoot a video today, so the light is off and everything's off, but I'm in the office and I just discovered something that I really want to share with you guys. Here it is. So for the past couple of days, I've been working on using the orchestration service of Generative AI Hub to implement a workflow where I would have a large language model that I query, obviously, and then I also wanted to use the grounding module. And we just released the possibility of using an S3 bucket to upload your documents, like PDF documents and whatever you want to use to ground your responses in. And I wanted to try out that feature, right? So I wanted to use the grounding module of the orchestration service, and I wanted to do that using an S3 bucket. And I've been doing that with Python code, and that has been working fine. And I will also shoot a video on that, but my code is kind of all over the place still, so I have to clean that up before I release it to anyone else. But then my colleague Kevin asked me, because he has a workshop with customers and partners that don't really want to code anything, but they still want to understand how it works, if you can also do that in the SAP AI Launchpad. And I have to admit something here right now. I have, until now, ignored the orchestration tab of the AI Launchpad. And I was wrong to do so. It's really cool. I just tried it out, and you can really implement an entire RAG scenario for people that have absolutely no idea how to code. You could just click it. And then, if you want, you could technically, in the end, download the JSON file and then use it somewhere in your request, wherever, in which language ever you want. I'm still going to stick to my Python code, because with the Python SDK, I feel like the code is cleaner and nicer, and I just understand it better. But anyway, it's possible, and you can do it in the AI Launchpad, and I want to show you because I was impressed. I think it's awesome. Let's go. Okay, so this is the first thing you see when you open AI Launchpad, right? You can connect your AI runtimes. I connected an AI core instance with the extended plan, so I have the Generative AI Hub available. And then I created a resource group with the, like here you see this little tag, and that basically means that grounding is enabled. Okay, now, since my last video on AI Launchpad is pretty old, let's admit it's pretty old. I'm going to give you a quick tour before I start. So here you have your Generative AI Hub tab, and you might not see the grounding one yet because you need to create a generic secret, which I will show you in a second, for this tab to appear. But you have the model library, and this one is awesome. So here you see all the models that we have available, and it's a lot. And here you can change the input types. Like, for example, you want a model that also can process images. So, I mean, a lot of them can already process images, right? That's not really super cool anymore, but here you see all the models. We also have the O3 model available, for example, and we also have, for example, the new Nova models available. Yeah, we have all kinds of models available, obviously, and also embedding models, reasoning. And if you don't know what model you should use, then you can also check the leaderboard. The leaderboard is really cool. You can either just have a look at this and look at the different scores. Now, the Helm score, for example, is, I think, probably the score that most people know. It was introduced by Stanford, and basically what they do here is they use, like, they take the different models, they ask the models the same question on different topics like astrology, geology, math, I don't know, all kinds of topics. They ask a question, and then I think they give like 4 answers. It's like multiple choice. So they basically give the models a multiple choice exam. And because if you would have free text as an answer, then you would have to determine which is better, right? That's difficult. So basically what you do is you let the models take a multiple choice exam, and then you decide on which model has like the least amount of hallucinations, right? That's the Helm score. But if you look at the chart, some stuff here is very interesting. You can change what you want to look at. So for example, I want to look at the context window, because that's usually interesting, I think, and the Helm rate. Okay. So which model do we have here? That's Gemini. Yeah, the Gemini models always have the biggest context window. And then the second one, still Gemini. what else do we have here? Nova has a big context window. And the best score though, so like the best performing model, is GPT-4o. Yeah, that's not really surprising either. What do we have here? Claude is good. Yeah. Turbo. Okay. And then maybe let's also add the output token cost. So here we can see the model with the highest cost, and the lowest context window is actually now disappearing, GPT-4. And the one with the biggest context window is Gemini, obviously, but it's also one of the models with the lowest cost, which is cool. That's what we have here. GPT-4 has, the 4.1 has quite a big context window and is not very expensive either. The mini one is cheap as well. Yeah. So the thing is, some people are wondering why, for example, the GPT-4 model here is a lot more expensive than this one. And that's just because, you know, when you research how you develop these models and then you build the next model more efficiently than the model before that. So it can be that it varies in like which model is released and the performance, the costs can vary as well. Because if your model runs faster or uses less parameters to run through, then that's obviously cheaper to use. So that's why sometimes it varies a little bit. But yeah, I think this is super interesting. And yeah, here you again have the leaderboard and the model catalog. And here, all these other features, all the model providers we have, which is obviously a lot. Here you can also filter on if it's SAP hosted or SAP managed. And well, then the remote ones are the ones that we proxy for. Okay, anyway, now let's move on. What you have to do in order to implement the use case that I was talking about is you open this administration part and you have to create a generic secret. First, before you do that, actually, there's one other thing. When you go into the chat window, so here you can basically just chat to any of the models. So you pick your model here, you can chat to any of the models. Now, before you can chat to any of these models, you have to actually create a deployment of the orchestration service instance. And that's just gonna be like, I think some banner here is gonna say like enable orchestration, and then you click that button and then it's gonna deploy all the models that are available and you can just use them in the chat and really just change the model here, right? By selecting a different model. So like this. Now we selected a different model. You need an orchestration deployment. You can check your deployments down here when you go to deployments, and then you will see, for example, I have one orchestration deployment running, and that's why in the chat I have all the models available. If your deployment is not running yet, then you don't have any model available to query. You can also just pick like a single model that you want to deploy. You have to do that, for example, when you want to use an embedding model, then you have to go there and deploy the embedding model. But that's super easy too. Like, for example, let's just try it out here. You can just say deploy, and it's going to deploy it. Okay, anyway, now let's move on. For our grounding pipeline, we need to create a generic secret. I already did that, but I'm just going to show you how. It's super easy. So what you have to do before you do this is create an S3 bucket. I honestly just use the object store service on BTP, which also creates an S3 bucket. And then you get all your service credentials and everything, right? I'm going to link a blog post and a tutorial in the comments where you see exactly what you have to put in here. But basically, it looks something like this. Yeah, so this is how it looks like. It has to be base64 encoded with all this information in here. Okay, then you give it a name. I gave it this very long, nice name, generic secret S3 AWS demo, because I'm very forgetful and I like long names to remember what it actually is supposed to do. And then what you just have to do is click document grounding, true, and then we use the type, which is S3, and then you say add, and it's gonna end it. Okay, now that we have this, this grounding management tab is gonna occur. If you didn't see it before, it should come up now. And if you select it, you can see my pipelines here. So the pipeline is extremely easy to create. It's literally a joke. You click on this, it already has the embedding model selected, and then you just select S3, and then the generic secret that we had available, and then you say create, and it's gonna create it. Okay, and if you click on the pipeline, you can see all the documents that I added. So I have four documents here that I added. And you can see the number of chunks and also the metadata, like what's the name of the PDF document, how can you download it, how many pages does it have, stuff like that. Okay, now what you could do is you can run a search. So if you click on this, you can already like type a query here and pick one of the repositories. And then it's going to show you which chunks would technically come up. This is how you can already check your grounding service and the performance. But what's actually really cool, and the thing that I want to show you, which I discovered, was if you choose the orchestration service. Okay, here we go. So in the orchestration service, you have the grounding module, the templating module, data masking, input filtering, and the model configuration, right? Okay, let's use the grounding one for now. Okay, so I go here because I want to use a different input variable actually. So I'm going to go to templating first, and I will say this is my request, and I'm going to call it grounding request, and then this is my context, right? So in this variable, the grounding output variable is going to hold the chunk or the chunks that were retrieved from your grounding pipeline. Okay, it's going to go in here. So that's going to be your context. And then whatever your user or you will ask is going to be the grounding request. Okay, you can obviously add like also like a default value or anything else here in your template. This is like the simplest template you could possibly have, but it's enough for now. And then here, now I can pick that one as my input variable. Output, as I said, will hold the chunks. So whatever output it's going to find in your grounding pipeline. And then here you have to specify which one to use. We will use this one. They have the same data, so it doesn't really matter. And down here, you can also say if you want to use more chunks. I'm going to just use 5 and see if it works. Okay, then here we have data masking. So here you can basically really hide phone numbers, any personalized information, right? Gender, passport numbers, telephone number, and whatever. I'm going to turn it off right now because I don't have any of those things in my dataset and we don't need it right now. And then here, if you have the input filter, you can either use the Llama Guard or the Azure Content Safety filter. I'm also going to turn this one off right now because I don't need it right now. and then the model configuration, we can pick a model. Let's use one of the Amazon ones just because that's what I've been trying out recently a lot. And we can test it here. And this button, I must say, I've ignored this entire tab, to be honest, but this button, I don't know, I just didn't really see it, and it's really cool. So first of all, here you can now download the JSON file. We can also look at it here. This is what you need if you send the request through, I don't know, like Bruno or Postman or whatever other post request you want to send. This is basically your configuration, right, that you have to send, the orchestration workflow configuration. And here you see our data repository, you see our model that we use, output parameter, and the grounding request as input parameter, and here you see our model template, prompt template. Yeah, okay, anyway, now we want to test it. Which models will be available in GenAI Hub through the partnership between SAP and AWS? Let's ask. The partnership between SAP and AWS will make the following generative AI models available through SAP's Generative AI Hub. Amazon Nova Micro, Amazon Nova Lite, Amazon Nova Pro. These models will join the existing access to Anthropic Claude and Amazon Titan. And that is so true. And the thing is, when you ask this question without grounding it in the partnership information, you get like a very weird response, obviously, because it can't know. But what I did, I fed the PDF documents that are in my S3 bucket are all documents on the partnership. So some news articles, some press releases from AWS and SAP where they announced the partnership. I also added the transcription of an open SAP course where they talked about the partnership. So I added all kinds of information about this partnership to my S3 bucket. And now I basically have this AWS SAP partnership expert. And yeah, you can just try it out here without having to do anything, like any coding. It's all just in the UI and super easy to understand and to use. And I just discovered it and wanted to share it with you because I love it. Yeah, so try it out and let me know what you think. Bye.